So this book appeared in already 4 years ago, and immediately after the English edition, there was the Italian one by Aboca. And this kind of system view is really the paradigm of today, we believe, to understand, interpret, and deal with life and science. And to understand why so, maybe the best way is to go back to what has been with us for the last 2-3 centuries, namely the Cartesian view of life, with this mechanistic vision of the world. Let me show you first Cartesian. You see, we are in the 17th century, the beginning. And this man really was instrumental to give a very strong impront to the philosophy and to science for 3 centuries. And you see, with this sharp division between body and mind, soul and matter. And although this can look a little black and white, this kind of picture of Cartesio, indeed, if you read his work, you really find very strong sentences about man being a machine and plants being machines. And and was also the period of the triumph of science. Science was invented in this period with Galileo. I say science was invented because before him, before this period, all what happened in nature, thunderstorm and tides and hail, and was due to mysterious forces or punishments of God. And with the advent of science, there was a turn, and all these phenomena of nature were interpreted, or at least seen, in turn instead of natural forces, of something that could be explained on the basis of, Galileo would say, of the language of mathematics. This analytical procedure was the procedure of the time in the sense that given a complex system, an organism or whatever, composed by many parts, so complex, what you do, you take the single part, you take one part at a time, you try to explain how this part works, then you put all this information of the different parts together, with the idea of having the picture of the complex system. This procedure, as I say, was very successful for centuries. He has the towering figure of Isaac Newton, really a giant in science. The man who discovered the falling of an apple from a tree follows the same physical law as the planets moving with respect to each other. If you think of it, a really bold, crazy idea. And his book was instrumental to bring really the notion that all could be explained in terms of science. However, there was also this drawback that was not giving too many problems at that time, until you know, with the beginning of last century, there was a kind of uproar, a kind of contemporary movement of a series of independent scientists and observers who began to really put in crisis this mechanistic view. And it would be nice to have time to discuss all these heroes of our modern time. But notions like self-organization, complexity, system thinking, emergent properties, very important, and non-linearity are very at the basis of this modern view of science. And you know, the question that these people pose to the mechanistic view is very simple. Look at a butterfly composed by many independent parts. These are almost a kind of silk material, this is kind of keratin, this is a jelly material, those are different parts. How all these different parts know that they belong to the same entity? You know, they move and... So there must be something that connects all this part, and if you take, you isolate the wing, and you can study all what you want about the wing, or you isolate this top part, but still you don't have the entire function and property. And if you look at this thing, which is even a little more complex than a butterfly, and you give a look at the organs, you see the liver, the kidneys, the lungs, the intestine, and you see all these arrows, which are not due to the fantasy of my friend Angelo, who is the artist always behind my books and my paper, but this arrow corresponds to a real functionality in the sense that the intestine is not independent. It has to do or has to follow what the stomach is doing. And it's not that the heart can beat the number of beats it wants without considering all the others. So one is dependent from the other. This is just like an orchestra where all the musicians have to be in tune with each other. There is not that each one can do its own business. And the harmony, the symphony, arises just because of the symphony of the being in tune of all these pieces. And this is, of course, true for our bodies, it's also true for the butterfly, but you can easily see that it's a metaphor that can be seen as valid for anything else. Think of the UNO, where, you know, those are the different countries, and you have a unity. You have a life, you have the entire complete organism where they are collaborated and touching and interacting with each other. Or you can see, you can look at the tribe where those are the different components. Or you can see that those are the cities of a nation. Or those are the nation of a continent. Then, you know, going back to the organism, may happen that with time, some of this liaison fell down until you arrive at a point where there is something that we call death. Even David would agree that death is death. Death is the picture of fragmentation, where the single part do not are maybe still there, you know, a body dies, the heart is still there, the liver can even work for a few minutes or hours, but there is no interaction anymore. That is the picture of lack of interaction. this is death and this is life. And if this is a typical question of mine to my students, here there is a living horse full of energy and jumping around. There is a dead horse, he just died. But this dead horse has all the blood, all DNA, all protein, all sugar, all vitamins of the dead horse. Why do you call it dead? And the clever student would then say, Herr Professor, this is the dead horse and this is the living horse.
Yes.
So life is seen as an interaction of part, and there would be much to add to this picture, as this interaction does also produce a series of new, what we call emergent properties, where perhaps we come back later. This life versus death is a, by the way, a continuous controversy between science and religion. I have many interaction with religious people, and the question of the origin of life and the definition of life has never been really a profound barrier between science and religion. But that is, as for science, with the death of the individual, only molecules remains. There is no vestige, there nothing remains of the individuality. Instead, the notion of soul, the notion of reincarnation is something all monotheistic religions would say, that with the death of the individual, something stays or is transmitted. And even the non-theistic religion, like Buddhism, more have something to say about that, that with the death is not that all disappear of the individual. Would be a big issue. Now, this kind of picture also induce another question. You can say, you know, all this story that this part interact with each other to give a unity. Well, this is true also for my watch. This is true for my car. But then, what is the difference with respect to a between a machine and a body, a living system? Well, here then we have to plunge into a subtle, difficult question. What is life and what is then the difference with respect to a machine? And this brings us, at least me and many scientists in this field of biophysics and chemistry, to the notion of autopoiesis by Umberto Maturana and Francisco Varela, good friend of mine. And they analyze, this Francisco in one of the very first Cortona Week, he passed away in 2001. Let's look, they were saying, at the cell, at perhaps a microbe, you know, unicellular organism, which are the simplest possible way of existence of life. So let's see how life works at this level. And let's simplify the cell with this cartoon, which however represents the main feature of a cell, with the semi-permeable membrane, which permits some nutrients to enter, only some, and some catabolites or something that is not of use anymore to go out. And inside you have many, many reactions. In each of your liver cells there are this moment, perhaps 10 or 10,000 chemical transformation, burning sugar, production of vitamin, hydrolysis of the proteins, and oxidation of. And then, if you look at the under the microscope at one of your cell or at an amoeba, then you have this paradox that there are thousands and thousands of chemical transformation, and yet the liver cell remains a liver cell, and the amoeba remains an amoeba for all the time of the observation. But this is also true for the lizard, remains a lizard, despite the fact that inside there are thousands and thousands of chemical transformation. How is this paradox possible? Actually, they would say, the main activity of the cell is to maintain itself. The liver cell wants to remain a liver cell, and the amoeba wants to remain an amoeba. But how is this possible? Because in face of this enormous number of information, it is possible because the cell is just something that remakes all what is being consumed. If you know. As much as I know that all hemoglobin of our body lives only a few days, then it's destroyed, but it's remade immediately by my body. And actually, 80% of our cells are going to be dead, destroyed, disappearing within 2 months, but are made again by my body. So life is a factory that makes continuously itself again, is autopoietic, where poietic, poios, means production, and auto means self. So it's a self-maintenance from within that characterizes life, and that my car and my watch cannot have, due to a dynamic network of interaction which are made by the system itself. It's a kind of cyclic logic procedure where you have a system which makes itself in order to maintain itself, makes itself from within in order, of course, all the expenses of energy and food coming from outside, as we have seen in the cartoon Maturana Varela.